And welcome everybody to the 33rd meeting in 2015 of the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee. Remind you that we should have phones turned to silent so that they don't interfere with the broadcast system. And you'll notice committee meetings using tablets for papers are now provided in digital format. Agenda item one today is the Land Reform Scotland Bill. And this business this morning is to welcome our panel, Richard Lochhead, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Food and Environment. Good morning, Richard. How are you?
Good morning.
And Billy McKenzie, Team Leader, EU Rural Development Programme and Agricultural Holdings, Andrew Campbell, Solicitor, and Stephen Sadler. Well, Angela Morgan instead of Stephen in the Land Reform and Tenancy Unit, is that correct? It is. Well, welcome to you all as well, officials. Cabinet Secretary, you want to say a few words at the start?
Thank you very much, Convener, and just let me say at the outset that I'm enormously grateful to the committee for rescheduling my appearance before you this morning, so thank you for your forbearance. In terms of today's evidence myself on the Land Reform Bill and those provisions relating to agricultural holdings, I don't need to tell this committee that tenant farming is, of course, very crucial to Scottish agriculture and to the Scottish economy. Tenant farming accounts for 23% of all agricultural land and provides a route into farming for new entrants in particular, and opportunities for those who don't have the capital resources to buy land. The contribution the sector makes is also vital to sustaining, as I said, our economy and particularly our rural communities. Yet despite previous reforms to agricultural holdings legislation, there continues to be a decrease in tenanted land in Scotland. Since 1982, there has been a 42% decrease, and Scotland now has one of the lowest proportions of tenanted land anywhere in Europe. This is what the Agricultural Holdings Review set out to address. And since the review group began its work back in January 2014, I do believe a lot has been achieved. And following an extensive stakeholder evidence gathering by the committee members, we had the final report, which was published in January, and now we have the proposed recommendations within that being taken forward, in some cases, through legislation. Measures such as the introduction of a tenant farming commissioner, improving how rents are set, an amnesty for tenants' improvements, and measures to widen assignation and succession rights for tenants. The aim of this part of the Bill, the Land Reform Bill, is therefore to create a vibrant and modern tenant sector that provides a range of letting opportunities for those who want to enter and progress within Scottish agriculture, to also provide a fair return to both the landlord and the tenant, and to provide those who want to leave the industry with a route to do so that hopefully allows them a reasonable return on their investment and the time, labour and finances they have put in, while ensuring at the same time the landlord's rights are also respected. Finally, I know the committee is just as aware as I am of the complexities of agricultural holdings legislation and the relationships between tenant farmers and landlords, and the importance of getting some of these issues right that we're addressing through this legislation and through other means out with this legislation as well. It's a very serious issue for the future of tenant farming in Scotland. We owe it to the next generation of farmers to bring forward solutions that hopefully do strike that balance between giving tenants the security and flexibility they need and ensuring the rights to property landowners and that these rights are respected. I do believe the provisions on the Tenant Farming Commission in Part 2 of the Bill and the Agricultural Holdings provisions in Part 10 do provide such a package of measures and hopefully will dramatically improve the framework for tenant farming in Scotland.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We're going to kick off by looking at one of these innovations, the Tenant Farming Commissioner. And when we had evidence at the beginning of the bill from the bill team, it was suggested that this function was an administrative one as opposed to a legal one, and therefore not appropriate to give the Tenant Farming Commissioner powers that could be seen to cut across the functions of the Land Court, etc. Do you know, when you think about the process of enforcing codes drawn up by the Tenant Farming Commissioner, why not empower the Tenant Farming Commissioner to enforce the codes, and after they are inquired into and find that they have perhaps been breached, why not give the Tenant Farming Commissioner those powers?
So let's address perhaps the motivation of creating a tenant farming commissioner in Scotland. I just referred to at the end of my opening remarks how we're all familiar with the complexities of agricultural holdings legislation in Scotland, and I think we're all familiar with some of the disputes that take place across Scotland and some of the history in terms of relationship between landlords and tenants and the various different arguments that can arise from those disputes over compensation, rent setting, or wherever that may be. The purpose of the Tenant Farming Commissioner is to give a focus to sorting out many of those disputes, to get to the root of some of these issues, to hopefully plug a gap that will allow less cases to be referred to Land Court, which I think both landlords and tenants don't want to go there if possible. And therefore, if we can find other ways of resolving some of these disputes by addressing some of the fundamentals by creating this office, so we've got an office solely focused on working with all the stakeholders to sort out some of these disputes, hopefully that will move the sector forward. There is also a naming and shaming element to this, in that whilst there may be individual disputes taking place across the country, where the Tenant Farming Commissioner takes up a case, and we have an interim Tenant Farming Commissioner at the moment who's already looking at some cases, then clearly that will shine a spotlight on those cases, and I hope that in itself, in some cases, will provide a deterrent for the disputes arising in the first place and lead to a much more productive relationship. And I guess the final point I just want to make is that in terms of the legal standing of the Tenant Farming Commissioner, whilst there are proposals for powers for penalties where information is not forthcoming from the parties to help the Tenant Farming Commissioner fulfil their duties, also the findings of any report carried out by the Tenant Farming Commissioner can be referred to by the Land Court. Therefore, it will be a material consideration by any cases that go to the Land Court. So there's a legal ramification, albeit, as the convener refers to, it doesn't go much further than that.
Well, we've been thinking about the relationship between the Tenant Farming Commissioner and the Land Court, and we've been interested to know whether you could give any consideration to changing the process whereby disputes between landlords and tenants can be resolved, because, for example, should certain types of disputes be referred to arbitration with a right of appeal to the Land Court, for a start? So after a breach has been found by the Tenant Farming Commissioner, what happens then?
Well, arbitration is there at the moment, but clearly I've just outlined what I think will be some of the benefits of creating this specific Office of the Tenant Farming Commissioner within the Land Commission, which is a first, and clearly we'll have to see how it performs. But I do, for the reasons I gave, think it will make a difference. There is a debate there, and clearly if the committee has specific views on how the process can be improved, you know, I am willing to consider anything you come forward with. I did say at the beginning of this process, we are dealing with quite difficult, complex issues. Therefore, the scrutiny process in the Parliament is very important, and if there are better ideas or improvements to our proposals for Stage 2, you know, we've got a relatively open mind, albeit we're constrained by how many we can take forward for time constraints.
The resolving of these disputes, which you've, you know, outlined so graphically, that lead me to ask these questions about, you know, should there be a requirement for parties? Can the Tenant Farming Commissioner require parties to go to mediation before going to the Land Court?
Well, I don't see why the Tenant Farming Commissioner could not do that. If you're suggesting that has to be more explicit in terms of the bill, I'll reflect on that.
Because, you know, then should a lack of willingness to go to mediation be a consideration of the court when it's determining costs?
Well, I think the priority is to avoid cases going to court where possible, and the cost clearly is a crucial element in trying to avoid going down that path. The Tenant Farming Commissioner is just one element in this whole package. Clearly, many of the other measures are also motivated by a desire to try and avoid disputes in the first place. Where there are disputes, the Tenant Farming Commissioner may have a role.
Well, I wondered about that because, you know, what role would they play in leading or administering or overseeing mediation and or arbitration? Because, you know, they are in a lead position to try and solve the problems, as well as having named and shamed, as you put it, if need be.
Well, as I said, you know, the Tenant Farming Commissioner is one element. There is legislation. There's a Tenant Farming Commissioner office, which is new. Excuse me. And until that office is established and we can, you know, have experience after a year or so of reflecting on its performance, it's quite difficult to predict what may have helped resolve some of these disputes if they don't have the tools available to them or not. So I think I've got a relatively open mind as to whether the committee feels that there should be more explicit powers given to the Tenant Farming Commissioner.
I'd just like to finish up this little section about codes which the Tenant Farming Commissioner will be enforcing. There is no mention about a statutory code for land agents. There is one which the land agents themselves have created as a voluntary code, but our experience in this committee suggests that we'd like to find out your views about whether there should in fact be a code for conduct which the Tenant Farming Commissioner can have oversight of with regard to the way that land agents behave in this whole process.
Well, there's no doubt my experience as both Minister and a constituency MSP that on occasion the behaviour and attitude of certain agents in Scotland add a lot of fuel to the fire in terms of existing disputes and even lead to disputes in the first place arising. So I do think there is a case, yes, for looking at such a code, definitely. Clearly, as Tenant Farming Commissioner, one of the reasons of establishing that office is to identify where there is a need for an extra code over and above what's there already, and then go and carry out the work to make that happen.
Farmer summed it up by saying that they had to earn three wages, one for themselves and their family, one to pay the land agent, and another to pay their rent to the landowner. So obviously that's quite a big part of their concerns about what they can raise from the units which they are farming. And therefore the question of a code is something we'd like to press on you to think about very seriously with regard to land agents.
Well, as I've indicated, I'm sympathetic to having such a code. I think there is a place for that. I think perhaps, more appropriately, the interim Tenant Farming Commissioner, and then once it's established, that's where to put the case to, because that will be the job of the Tenant Farming Commissioner, is to create those codes and work with the stakeholders. So I'm happy to hear the representations in the committee, but I think also in due course we have to make these representations to Tenant Farming Commissioner, because that will be their job to create those codes.
Okay. Let's move into some of the details about agricultural holdings as such. The question of confidence and the government's proposals. Mike Russell's going to kick off.
Morning. You made quite a lot in your opening statement about the desire that you have, and I think all of us would agree with that desire, of both increasing the rights of tenants and also giving confidence to landlords that they could let land. And I think, were that possible, I think that would be a desirable aim. But we haven't, I don't think, taken any evidence that suggests that the confidence of landlords will be increased in any way by these measures. In fact, quite the reverse. And therefore, it would seem to me, certainly, and from the evidence that we've had, that one of those aims has to predominate in terms of the public interest. Which of those aims should predominate in terms of the public interest?
Well, the objective of this legislation is to create a vibrant tenancy sector in Scotland. And whilst I appreciate where you're coming from with your question, I recognise that we need both land on the market available to be let, as well as tenant farmers with the skills and the ambition to run their own farms and put food on our tables. And if one of those elements is missing, we won't have tenant farming in Scotland. So we have to strike that balance. But clearly, if we don't have the ability for tenant farmers to invest in their farms and have confidence themselves to invest in their farms, as well as landlords to let their land in the first place, then tenant farming and agriculture generally is going to be held back in Scotland. I can only say to landlords who are saying to Michael Russell or to the committee that they are not seeing their confidence increasing as a result of this legislation, well, clearly, if their position is freedom of contract, then any safeguards or enforcement of these safeguards perhaps will not be all that welcome if you want complete freedom of contract. But we believe it's in the public interest to have those safeguards, and therefore there is a lot of emphasis in the legislation on providing those safeguards to the tenants, because in a position of power, those with land tend to have more power than those without land, and therefore we have to go that extra mile to offer protection to tenant farmers in Scotland. So there is no doubt an emphasis on protection for tenant farmers in the legislation.
Okay. I don't think, I would certainly not disagree with you about the need to protect tenant farmers and to increase the rights of tenant farmers. I think the real issue here is if you're going to do that and landlords are then not willing to let land, then your actions will have to be taken if you wish to continue land to be available. Now, in other circumstances, if one takes historical parallels, in the crofting circumstance, it was the state which in the end intervened and became the crofting landlord when there was a parallel situation. You could look at this in the context of the 1948 Act, and again, it was the state that was prepared to see circumstances, for example, local authorities, I wouldn't recommend that, but public bodies owning land and tenanting it. If landlords do not, as a result of this bill, increase or perpetuate the amount of land in tenancy, is it possible we'll end up with something that doesn't meet either objective? Because the changes to the tenancies are designed to help tenants, but if their landlords are less and less keen to have tenants, then the situation will continue to deteriorate. Would it not be better to look at whether circumstances demand it, and there are circumstances in Scotland that demand it, an absolute right to buy, and thereafter circumstances in which where landlords don't want to let land, the state is able to intervene and ensure that land is available to let through the market mechanisms?
Where I do agree with you is that we need a basket of options and measures via legislation or via other support mechanisms through the Rural Development Programme or wherever to promote tenant farming in Scotland and diverse agriculture in this country. This subject today we're discussing is part of a land reform bill. So it's agricultural holdings measures within a land reform bill. That land reform bill is part of an overall programme of land reform. And with the Land Commission being set up, as we've previously discussed in this committee, and you took evidence in the briefs from my colleague, Aileen McLeod, this is going to be an ongoing process. And I think you're absolutely right. We'll have to reflect on the success or otherwise of the measures we're taking. I'm confident there will be a positive impact of those measures. Whether it goes far enough, only time will tell. And clearly, there are many complex factors out there influencing the future of tenant farming. It's not simply legislation, and it's not simply some of the factors that dominate our headlines. It's demographics, it's all kinds of issues. And therefore, it's very difficult to identify the silver bullet that's going to get us where we want to overnight. But we have to have our minds open. And as you're also aware, we are exploring other options within government of using publicly owned land to have new starter units and new leases for tenant farmers. And the powers under these measures we're discussing today for a right to buy where the landlord's not fulfilling their obligations is a radical step forward. It's not an absolute right to buy, as for reasons well documented in front of the committee previously. So I think we are going in the direction that you're suggesting, Mr. Russell, but we have to be more inventive in the future, and I don't dispute that.
Can I narrow that down to the issue of human rights? Because land reform is, and tenancy reform, is about human rights. And we've seen some alarming cases in recent times where certainly it appears as if the human rights of some tenants are not being respected in the way they should be. And you and I both know we've had constituency experiences of that taking place as well. The human rights legislation, however, is being quoted often by landlords to say that the right to property is absolute. And indeed, if you look at the 1886 Crofting Reform Act, it's questionable whether it could be passed at the present time, given the way in which rights under Article 1, Protocol 1 are being at least interpreted by some. So don't we need to focus more closely on the human rights of those who use the land, human rights of those who have put effort into the land? Some people have had tenancies for up to a century, and the human rights of communities, as anticipated, for example, in the UN Convention on Social Economic Rights, and put those into the balance against perhaps those who are trying to argue that the rights of property trump everything. And if you do that, then we do need a more radical approach to tenancy as well as the other issues in the bill.
I absolutely agree that we have to bring the human rights of tenant farmers in Scotland more to the fore. I do believe we are doing that. For instance, some of the criticisms of some of the measures we're discussing today from landowners are that we are infringing their human rights and we are going too far. Whereas, of course, I'm here saying to the committee today, no, we're not. We're doing what's right for the public interest, because property rights are not absolute, but they are, of course, an important dimension of this debate, because we all have to respect property rights. But the public interest, of course, also has to be respected. So I do think we are paying a lot of attention to the human rights of tenant farmers, and that's why some of these measures are radical. They may not be radical enough for some, and others believe they're too radical, but I believe we're going in the right direction. I can only reiterate to Michael Russell and the committee that this is not the end of the debate, and the land reform agenda is very important to tenant farming in Scotland in the general sense. It's not just about agricultural holdings legislation. But clearly, Michael Russell referred to 1948 legislation in his initial remarks. So I have to say that this is not 1948, and this is a challenge for all legislators. This is not 1948, it's 2015. And therefore, we have to take into account the legislative and international environment in which we operate. And we don't have the same abilities legally as we have perhaps had either just before the war or just after the war. So ECHR rights are very important to be taken into account.
I would be very surprised, I have to say, and you and I are old friends, I'd be very surprised but happy to debate with you as to whether human rights should in actual fact be deeper and better entrenched in 2015 than they were in 1948. And therefore, you know, any argument that would say people were freer to operate in 1948 might not succeed. We should be doing better than our parents or grandparents are doing. Just one final point, just slightly off of the tangent. We've had raised with us as a committee on two occasions now, and I've had correspondence about the continuing plight of small landowners who are smallholders who are left essentially in a legal limbo. I raised this with officials at the start of this process of open sessions. I raise it again. I don't believe it would be right to leave them again without redress. As has been pointed out to us, what happens to these smallholders is when they become infirm and cannot operate a smallholding, essentially that smallholding perishes. The land is left to go to ruin. The buildings collapse because there is no way through to the next stage. It is very important that those people get some assistance, and I would hope the government would try and bring forward some amendments at stage two to begin to redress that situation. There are a lot of people out there who are suffering.
Thank you. Okay. Well, in terms of just very briefly your first points, again, I do agree with Michael Russell. We do have to rekindle the spirit of previous generations where access to land and the ability to grow our own food as a country, you know, have to be seen as national priorities. Again, I do believe we are rekindling that spirit at the moment, and this is a very ambitious land reform agenda, of which the agricultural holdings is one part. And as I said before, whilst the political and legal environment we operate in 2015 is different to 1948, and these things are not easily changed, we do have to be inventive to get to where we want to get to with the justice and equality in Scotland in terms of access to land and being able to ensure the next generation of people to grow food for our country. And I've given some examples, I hope persuades Michael Russell and others that we are going in that direction. In terms of your second point about small landholders, I can only assure the committee that we are looking at this, and of course we carried out the recent survey. I trust that that information has been communicated to the committee. If not, we'll check that after this meeting today. We carried out the survey. We had quite a good response from those we were able to survey. And there's still a lot more work to be done. So while I cannot give a commitment to the committee, there'll be stage two amendments, I can give a commitment. This is on the government's agenda, and we are actively looking at these issues. One of the considerations is even the self-identification of small landowners in Scotland, even that's not simple. So if we pass legislation without being able to know who it applied to, I think that'd be not wise. Therefore, there's a bit more work to be done.
Thank you.
So, Alec Ferguson, points on this?
Yes, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. It's nice to see you. Up until now, I have largely agreed with Mike Russell. Up till very recently, I've largely agreed with Mike Russell, something you might find surprising. In that it's very difficult to deliver both of the objective of recreating a vibrant tenanted sector, which you quite rightly say is the policy objective of this part of the legislation, and increasing the rights and protection for tenants. And I think that it, and I believe it actually is possible to do both of those things, but I don't think it's possible to do that within the bill as it's laid before us at the moment. You quite rightly mentioned the importance of the relationship between landlord and tenant as being, and the need to restore confidence between those two parties if this is to be successful. And I think there are, I don't think the landlord side of it is simply freedom of contract or else. I think that would be the preferred position, but I don't think that's a deal breaker, so to speak. But what I do think there is a feeling that the legislation as it stands bears more similarity to a sort of blunt intervention measure, which doesn't really have which is seen as punitive, if I could put it that way. And what I'm really trying to get at is that I do believe that by a more targeted approach that would effectively address the problems that the Land Reform Review Group highlighted, and which I'm not going to deny we have seen some of in evidence, a more targeted approach to address those issues rather than the broad brush approach of the bill might help to achieve that confidence and be a win-win on all sides of this debate. You mentioned there's a need to stay open-minded as we go forward. Are you open-minded enough to take on board a change of approach, to have a more targeted approach to address the problems without the broad brush approach that some see as punitive and is undoubtedly setting minds against what you're trying to achieve?
Well, clearly I'll study carefully the committee's recommendations in terms of the stage one report. I can only reiterate some of the statistics which we're all aware of, which is the amount of rented land in Scotland has declined from 40% to 23% over the last 30 years. The total area of land let in Scotland, including crofts but excluding seasonal lets, fell by 44% from 1982 to 2015. I simply reiterate those statistics because in terms of the debate around government intervention, clearly the market and self-regulation or lack of regulation in some areas or poor regulation in other areas is not delivering the outcomes we want to see as a country. So I think there is a case for state intervention for the government to make sure that there's a backstop there to protect the rights of tenant farmers as well as ensure that it's attractive to let land in the first place in Scotland. I don't have a completely open mind on all the measures in the bill. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that clearly we are not ruling out stage two amendments, and if there are specific areas where the committee believe that can be improved upon, you know, we have an open mind in that context.
Well, I may come to one or two suggestions as we go through this part of the evidence taking. Thank you, Convener. Thank you.
Just when we're dealing with this at the moment, clearly we've debated already the statement of rights and responsibilities, which is right at the start of this bill, in which, you know, we have a very strong interest in making sure as many people take part in the creation of that statement. Presumably, elements of landlord-tenant relationships will be reflected, at least in the principles that are stated therein, and that will give a hint that this is an area which, you know, we're prepared to continue to intervene in until we get it right.
Yes, and it all comes down to the rights and responsibilities of land ownership in Scotland, and that can be in relation to impact on communities or tenant farmers. So yes, you're right, the principles apply right across the board.
Well, we'll see how that pans out. Thank you for that. Move on to another aspect of this relationship, Graham Day.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Maybe just sort of leads on from your last comments. How would you judge the success of the bill in this area? Would it be halting the decline in the amount of land under tenancy, increasing it, having more tenancies? Where would you hope we might be 5-10 years from now?
Well, from 5 to 10 years from now, I hope that we have a more vibrant tenant farming sector in Scotland, where both tenants feel more confident to invest in their holdings and where there is a more healthy availability of land to let in Scotland. As I said previously, I am confident the bill will play a role in helping that to happen, but it will certainly not be the only factor that will contribute towards making that happen for the reasons I referred to previously. This is a complex issue. The capital value of land is not something that's in control of this bill. Demographics is not something that's in control of this bill, changing society and economics. So.
If I may, Convener, you reiterated the word vibrant there, and in your opening remarks you also talked about a modern tenanted sector. But what about a genuinely viable one? In the course of taking evidence in the bill, we've come across examples of tenants who are basically scraping a living, in some cases only by having jobs away from their farms, because of the physical and the productive capacity limitations of the tenancies they have. Do you have concerns about the financial viability of many tenancies at the moment? And if you do, how do you think the bill might help address that going forward?
Well, there's the general answer to that question, of course, which is that I have that concern in relation to agriculture across the board. There are many examples in Scotland of agriculture in some sectors or some parts of the country being too fragile. And that's an ongoing challenge for government of whichever colour to address that. And that's also a European issue as well as a Scottish issue as well. And therefore, some of the tenant farmers perhaps you've spoken to will be experiencing some of the turmoil and volatility in agriculture more generally. In terms of this bill, as I indicated previously, I think where the bill can help is if we can create an atmosphere where the tenants feel more confident investing in their own holding, and they'll get a return from that in due course. Clearly that can help lead to more productive and active agriculture on our farms and in turn better profitability. So these issues are linked, and this bill therefore does play a role in supporting agriculture.
Okay. Anyone, any supplementaries to that? No? Okay. Looking then at modern limited duration tenancies, which flows on from this, Jim Hume.
Morning, of course, Cabinet Secretary, it's good to see you. There's been some concern, particularly from STFA, who have thought the MLDTs are more appropriate as bolt-ons to existing farm businesses. This was also echoed quite vociferously at our public meeting in Dumfries by some, what I think was a young farmer, that it's, again, it's more for the farm that wants to expand into the neighbouring farm, perhaps. I just wonder why the MLDTs are aimed at existing farmers rather than new entrants. Surely we should be trying to encourage new entrants.
Well, whilst the modern limited duration tenancy applies to all farmers in terms of those that want to take out non-1991 tenancies, there is an element within it, of course, which specifically addresses new entrants, in that the 10-year modern tenancy can be broken after 5 years for new entrants to give them the opportunity of reflecting on their first 5 years in the farm, and should they want to change that relationship, they'll have the opportunity to opt out as a new entrant. So we do take into account the needs of new entrants in the context of the new tenancy. There are, of course, some flexibilities that are not in the existing limited duration tenancies that are going to be in the modern tenancy. So there are similarities, of course there are, there's just a couple of differences, but these differences are relating to flexibility. The review group that looked at this issue clearly made the recommendation that's more flexibility required, and the emphasis should be trying to encourage 10-year tenancies, because clearly that's more stability for the new entrant or any farmer, rather than 5 years. So albeit 5 years still there, 10 years has just got a bit more emphasis to try and encourage people to go for longer term leases.
Mm-hmm. And just to further, are there any other sort of protections you think may be available for new entrants within that? And is the government considering bringing forward amendments to perhaps address some of the tenant federations associations' concerns in the stage two or three?
Well, as I said previously, I'm keen to look at the evidence you received from your Dumfries meeting, and we will look at that carefully as we look to stage two, and no doubt you'll reflect that in your own recommendations. So yes, I will look at that, and in terms of the other flexibilities, I think it relates to negotiations over fixed equipment on the farm, and hopefully it will make that a bit smoother in terms of that, the 10-year lease.
Yeah, I think that's the point. Thanks.
Another supplementary on this part just now. Yeah.
Thank you, Convener. We took evidence from the Crown Estate recently in relation to their attitude towards tenancies, and we heard that as part of a very considered succession planning for the next generation, they're issuing tenancies that run up to 37 years in duration, taking the tenants up to the age of 65. I would just welcome your views on that approach, Cabinet Secretary, and whether you think that's one that could be kind of fed into the mix here to improve the general situation.
Well, I very much welcome leases of those terms, because clearly that is a career span for any new entrants, and therefore, if we want to encourage new entrants, giving them that opportunity is a good incentive. So I welcome what you're saying about the Crown Estate and a 37-year lease. So whilst I welcome that, there's a separate question as what should be in legislation, and we're here to discuss legislation. So whilst I'd want to encourage others to follow the example of the Crown Estate, who clearly had the confidence to give those leases of that length of time, I hopefully would find other landowners to have that same confidence. So I welcome that. But in terms of legislation, there's a different question over what we should legislate over.
Okay. Thank you. Alec Ferguson's going to look at the next element of this.
Thank you, Convener. And just looking at conversion, Cabinet Secretary, which is an interesting one. And I think particularly it ties into the question that Graham Day's just asked, because I think the bit that we found interesting about the Crown Estate's model was the flexibility that it allowed in having not just a fixed term, but a term based on the retirement age of the next generation, and I think we all found that to be considerable. So it could be 15 years, it could be 37 years, as we heard, but it allows the flexibility that, while also giving a clear definition of why that's in place. And I think that's the sort of approach that people could buy into and have total faith in, if I could put it that way. And it's important in this one, I think, because as you'll be aware, the review group recommended that 91 Act tenants should be able to convert to a 35-year lease. The actual length of the lease has not been included in the bill, but there is a power for ministers to set the duration. One of the bits of evidence we took was a suggestion that the longer the converted lease was, the harder it would be for new entrants, and we are talking about trying to create churn here, to be able to compete with existing farmers for it, because obviously the longer it is, the greater the value. And I just wondered whether there is any chance of the government providing more details on its thinking as part of this bill, rather than leaving it to further future legislation, because obviously it's quite hard for us to comment really decisively on this without knowing what's being thought about.
Okay. Well, it's important to note that the purpose behind this measure of allowing the 1991 tenancies to be converted to the new modern limited duration tenancies is to actually encourage a bigger churn of tenancies in Scotland for a couple of reasons. Firstly, if the tenancy was lost, full stop, then there's one less tenancy. Therefore, to have a follow-up tenancy means there's still that tenancy available to someone else. And secondly, the fact that it can be assigned on value to a new entrant clearly gives an incentive for those who may be hanging about because there's no other option, despite the fact they may feel that their best years are behind them. It will give them incentive to leave the industry with dignity and again make that tenancy available. So I would dispute that this will lead to less tenancies and more frustration for new entrants, because I think actually, if it works properly, it will lead to more opportunities for new entrants.
I'm sorry to interrupt, sorry. But no, the point was, and the point was given to us in evidence, was that the longer that the stated minimum term of the lease, the harder it would be for people to get it. So I'm really, what I'm looking for is whether you're open to a greater flexibility in that term of the lease.
Well,
I
take your point. I think the point I was just trying to make was the net benefit of the measure.
Yeah, yeah.
Would be an overall increase in tenancies and opportunities for new entrants. Your specific question, I understand. So this is something that we've not reached a decision on yet, and therefore we'd welcome the committee's views. Clearly, we're taking the power. There's some discussions and working on with stakeholders in the coming months as to how best to implement that through secondary legislation. The review group made one recommendation of 35 years. There's a variety of other scenarios, so we're working these through with the stakeholders.
Well, thank you for that. Perhaps just on the subject of secondary legislation, I'd be inconsistent, convener, if I didn't mention my normal grumble about the amount of this legislation that has been left to secondary legislation. I do appreciate that it's similar to previous land reform legislation, but my concern is not so much the number as some of the substantive, really quite substantive parts of this that are being left to secondary legislation. And I'll just put it on the record for about the 10th time that I have. I do find that makes scrutiny of this legislation much more difficult.
Okay.
I know what your answer is, but...
For the 10th time, noted.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Okay. The tenant's right to buy. Dave Thompson.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary and your team. Section 80, as you know, removes the current requirement for tenants to register their interest in the right to buy their holding, and that's been pretty widely supported by most organisations. However, the Law Society of Scotland have raised a number of practical problems that they envisage in relation to this. For instance, they've suggested that the type and extent of a tenancy may be disputed. They've looked at the requirement to register. What they suggest is the requirement to register actually allowed these issues to be dealt with at an early stage, because once somebody registered their interest, if there was any dispute over whether it was a 91 tenancy or the boundaries of the tenancy, that could be resolved fairly earlier on. And they pose the question that it might create a number of practical problems. There's also an issue raised by them in their submission to us that what if only part of the subjects of sale are affected? If a landlord decides he wants to sell a part of a tenancy for development or whatever, what happens to the rest? So they've raised a number of interesting potential legal problems, and I just wonder if you feel that any of these have real substance, or you know, what you think the consequences of these things may be if the Law Society are correct.
Well, we are considering the Law Society's comments, and clearly we'll have to reflect on that as well. The benefits of removing the requirement to register is for a couple of reasons. There's a couple of benefits. Firstly, there is the issue that perhaps, as we understand anecdotally, some tenant farmers do not want to register in case it harms the relationship between themselves and the landlord. And secondly, many felt that perhaps the process was too complex and needless. Therefore, the easiest thing to do and to simply implement it is just to remove the requirement to register. The existing triggers, of course, are already there. So some of the issues I think the Law Society are raising with the committee, well, they're ongoing, I guess, because there's no difference in terms of the context of these concerns, because there's triggers already there that will continue to be there as to what defines the farm going up for sale. So there's nothing new that would perhaps influence that through the removal of the requirement to register. Saying that, you know, we recognise there's more work to be done on this, and we'll look at that.
Well, thank you very much. I'm reassured by your comments. That's very, very helpful indeed. And of course, I suppose if a landlord is proposing to sell, it's not a whim. It's not a spur of the moment thing. So I would imagine, would you agree that most landlords, if they are planning to sell, would have given probably some considerable thought to it, and therefore, if they thought there were issues around these matters, that you would expect them to have considered them at a very early stage in any case?
I think that's entirely right. That's a very good point. And sometimes concerns are expressed to the government about the legislation not catering for particular scenarios, but then it's quite difficult to find evidence of those scenarios ever arising. So, you know, we can only work with what we do know that actually happens in reality, and some of these issues are genuine, some are not. And I think in the vast majority of cases, as Dave Thompson says, a lot of thought is put into these decisions, and they're carried out in a very respectful way, where the landlord will speak to the tenant and the tenant will be aware of what's happening, and it's all open and above board. Yes, legislation has to cater for the very few extreme examples where things are not like that, and that's important. That's why the legislation is important. But yeah, you're right, in the vast majority of cases, people are responsible.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're looking at the sale where the landlord is in breach. Angus MacDonald, lead.
Thank you, convener. And firstly, apologies for appearing late due to traffic congestion. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning to your team. With regard to a sale where the landlord is in breach, Section 81 contains a process where the tenant can apply to the Land Court for an order for sale if the landlord has not complied with an order from the Land Court. Is it possible to give us a figure on how many cases there have been where the Land Court has made an order requiring a landlord to make good a material breach of their obligations?
I think it's fair to say we're only aware of one case where that has happened. We're only aware of one case, so clearly it's a system that's not working too well.
Okay.
Or that there's just no need to go to court in the first place.
Yeah.
Or people feel that court's not the best option.
And would you regard that situation to continue?
Say again, sorry.
Well, I'll just move on.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, yeah.
But with regard to the issue of the buyer of last resort, when the committee took evidence on the 16th of September, the issue was raised of who would be the buyer of last resort if the landlord was ordered to sell, but the tenant then didn't buy, and possible options that were suggested obviously included local authorities, the new Crown Estate, and or the Scottish Government. So who does the Government intend would be the buyer of last resort if the tenant didn't buy following a successful application to force a sale?
Well, I think the potential parties you outlined are potential options, but we are going to have to bring forward secondary legislation to define the process for a third party buying the farm, because clearly that will need a little bit of work to get that right. So we will do that.
Okay, but the three options will be there.
But you give some examples of perfectly legitimate parties that could potentially be the third parties.
Thank you. Now, if I could move on to the issue of clawback. The STFA have some concerns regarding the provision in Section 38N, which allows a former landlord to claw back some of the increase in the value of the land if it's sold on at a profit within 10 years. Now, the STFA and their evidence have suggested that, in effect, the original landlord should only be able to claw back any increase in value of his or her original interest in the lease and the land. So, as it stands in Section 38N, it would, according to the STFA, hinder any attempt by the tenant to borrow to allow the purchase of the holding due to concerns regarding the size of the clawback that may or not be the case. So will the provisions on clawback where a tenant sells on exclude clawback of the value of the improvements that the tenant has made in the time that he's been there?
I'll look at that clearly. I'll have to reflect on that and get back to the committee. The purpose of the clawback, I'm sure, as you're aware, is to ensure that this process is only undertaken in the spirit of the legislation, which is to allow the land to be farmed and the tenant farmer to have a better future, where the landowner is not fulfilling their obligations. So that's why there's a clawback provision in there. Can I reflect on your point there and come back to the committee?
Okay, I'd appreciate that, Cabinet Secretary, but you know, clearly the STFA do have a strong argument in this, given that it would be the tenant who will have made the investment that has created the profit if the land is sold on. So,
point that should be deducted from the clawback, but you know, can I just reflect on that?
Okay, thank you.
Any supplementaries on that? No? Okay. We're looking now at rent reviews, and Claudia Beamish will lead on that one.
Right, thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and welcome. And also, good morning to the officials. The rent review issue, as you're only too aware, and the committee is aware as well, has been a very challenging issue for tenants and indeed for landlords, and there's been legislation around it of which we're all aware as well. So trying to get this as fine-tuned as possible is obviously very important. And in section 82, there's, in my own view, quite a lot on the face of the bill, which actually sort of is itemised, which I won't go into now. There are also issues which, in order for there to be real confidence in this challenging aspect of tenancy, still need to be resolved. And one of that is the issue of going forward, as the bill states, with productive capacity as the judge of the rent. So I'm wondering if you could comment at all on what the committee has come across, that there are some concerns about that, that Rick says that on farm capacity, productivity, that there might be a substantial increase, we heard in evidence, in rents, which would be very concerning. The definition will obviously be very important, and the transparency of it, and some have argued for the simplicity of it, but then I know that those that are working on it have had what I think is called a non-exhaustive schedule of factors. And I'm not in any way criticising the fact that that is quite long already, because it is a very complex issue. But I wonder if you could comment on how this is progressing at all.
Thank you. Well, clearly the source of how rents have been set in the past, the way in which rents have been set in the past has very much been the source of many of the disputes that we're aware of in tenant farming. And my understanding is that the vast majority, if not all, stakeholders do support moving away from open market value being the main criteria to the productive capacity of the farm, which is much more realistic. And, you know, we have to have some criteria to give guidance on how to set rent, so you can't guarantee it's going to mean a reduction or an increase in whichever circumstance, but as long as it's a fair and open and transparent criteria that's used for the setting of rent, I think that's a good thing, and that's why the stakeholders seem to support what we're proposing here. And of course, it's come from a lot of work that's taken place among stakeholders in terms of what we're putting into the bill. There's a lot of modelling that has been taking place and will continue to take place in conjunction with stakeholders to define the productive capacity of farms. And, you know, we recognise that's very important. So that's underway, that work, and that will be used to provide guidance. But to put in legislation, this measure will be very helpful, and it will give the Land Court, of course, the ability to use a different criteria when it comes to settling disputes over rent, if indeed they do reach the Land Court.
Mm-hmm. Right, thank you. And in terms of the minutes we've received from the Rent Review Template stakeholder meetings, some of which are not public yet, I'm not going to comment on those, but it makes it quite difficult for the committee on a number of those issues on which agreement has not yet been reached. This isn't a criticism of the group, because I understand slightly the complexities of it. But it would be helpful. We have to do our stage one report, and it would be helpful if we could, if the group could be encouraged to move on as fast as they can, I say with respect to them. I don't know if you have anything to say about that.
Okay, well, I'll reflect on that and see if there's anything we can do there to make more information available to the committee. I'm sure we can at least ensure you're up to speed as much as possible by the time you're doing a report on where things have got to with defining productive capacity and the modelling that's taking place.
Right, thank you.
Alec Ferguson and Jim Hume.
Question to the Cabinet Secretary. You may not be able to answer it, I don't know, but I know that one of the sticking points is this business of surplus accommodation on a farm, housing really, and I just wondered if you're able to update us as to whether any progress is being made on that issue.
That is an issue, and some people have raised concerns with us over that, so if you're happy, I'll come back to the committee on that particular point. I have looked into it, and it's not the easiest to understand in terms of it's very complex as to the arguments that go either way. So I'd like to just reflect on that and come back to you.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
And Jim Hume?
Modelling, you see the work's still ongoing. It would be good to know when that would be concluded, because obviously in our considerations we really need to know this crucial part of the bill, what the actual effects would be on the ground. And I think the modelling is obviously crucial for us to understand fully what the effects would be. So is there a date that we know yet that modelling will be concluded by?
No, I don't have a date. I can just reiterate to the committee that this is clearly a significant measure which has been the source of many disputes over a long time and which has a lot of support. So adopting the principle and the new policy in the bill is quite important, even if we have to do the follow-up work to actually define productive capacity, etc. afterwards. So it's a question of, it's very important we should really get it into legislation as quickly as possible. Everyone feels that is the case, and therefore if there is work to be done afterwards, we'll do that as quickly as possible.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Moving on to succession and assignation, Dave Thompson's going to lead off.
Thank you again, convener. If we look at assignation and so on and succession, the bill is proposing to substantially widen potential assignees or successors, and the policy memorandum indicates that part of the reason for this is to modernise succession through the family to younger, more active members. And I just wonder, Cabinet Secretary, if you could clarify the policy intention of this part of the bill. What is the fundamental reason why the bill is dealing with this, which I think is really important, as there may be challenges under ECHR in relation to this particular section?
The review group clearly looked into this issue in detail, and it was felt that widening the class of relatives and people who can be assigned a tenancy or who can succeed is very important for the future of tenant farming in Scotland for a number of reasons. Firstly, there's demographics, and families today are different to families 100 years ago, and therefore you may have to spread the net a bit wider to other relatives if families are smaller, for obvious reasons, and therefore this will help address that. There's also the need to allow families to have more longer-term planning. So if they've got more options, they can plan succession in a much better timescale, and that, of course, is good for stability and good for the business. And then, of course, the key reason is to keep lands in tenancies. And if the option is not being able to assign it to anyone because there's no one obvious who would be able to take over the lease, therefore the tenancy could be lost and there'd be a reduction in tenanted land. Therefore, this would hopefully ease land staying within the tenanted sector as well.
Thank you very much for that answer. Some people have suggested that open assignation, you know, would be a better way to ensure that tenancies were retained, because then the tenant farmers could decide who they wish to assign the tenancy to. I wonder if you can just maybe comment briefly on that point.
Again, the review group looked at this and took the view, and I think with reasonable grounds, that if the net is cast wide enough, in the vast, vast majority of cases, hopefully that will allow someone else to succeed or be assigned the lease, and that land will continue to be farmed. If you were to go to open assignation, clearly there's the wider debate within agriculture is how do you ensure that we do have land coming onto the market and that there's a sense of fairness within the system. And, you know, open assignation would give the impression, according to what the committee were hearing, that the land is lost, you've lost control of the land forever, open assignation would be forever, and so on and so forth. And it just introduced that element of insecurity for landowners. So it's just striking that balance again. But you know, this is a very ambitious measure because the cast in terms of near relatives and relatives will be cast far and wide.
Would you feel, Cabinet Secretary, that open assignation, and you've explained that very well, would actually strengthen any particular challenge under ECHR? Scottish Land and Estates have made a supplementary submission to the committee on this, claiming that this part of the bill, I think all of it from what they're saying, is out with the legislative competence of the Parliament. I just wonder if you could assure us that you feel that it is within your legislative competence.
Well, clearly I wouldn't want to comment on the legal advice on these sort of specifics, but they are factors we have to take into account in terms of what stage any measure infringes on property rights, as we've previously discussed in relation to other questions. So these, of course, are factors in our decisions, and no doubt were factors that the review group had to have at the back of their mind as well. But the primary focus of the review group making this recommendation to not go down the route of open assignation was the need to maintain confidence within the overall tenancy sector in Scotland.
Yeah, thank you.
I think we've got Alec Ferguson, then Mike Russell, and then Claudia Beamish. Yeah,
yeah, just a point that has been put to us that I would appreciate your opinion on is that responsible landlords of letting estates whose business is letting land need from time to time the flexibility to adjust the units to ensure that those units remain viable. We've already spoken about the difficulty of right across the agricultural sector at the moment. And farming has changed a lot over the years. Obviously, units get bigger or in some cases smaller. How does this part of the bill tie in with that need for flexibility for units to be altered? Are we not in danger of perpetuating non-viable units through these measures?
We believe we strike a good balance in ensuring there's enough flexibility with ensuring that we can keep land in tenancies for the future of agriculture in Scotland. At the same time, we have to be careful that we do not allow anyone to place obstacles in the way of those tenancies being assigned or succession. And you know, there's clearly an argument that using the viable unit argument would be an obstacle to stop the farm being assigned or succession taking place. So we are reasonably sceptical of the arguments around viable unit and how that's defined and how it's used within this debate.
But surely there is a mechanism that would say if somebody puts a case that a certain unit needs to be basically divided between two other units to make them more viable when it's become vacant, surely on a condition that it is relet, there needs to be some flexibility within the system to allow units to remain viable.
Yeah, this has been a bit of a debate. I think the point I'm just making is we have to be careful. We do not allow this to be abused and become an obstacle to assignation or succession, and we're very conscious of that.
Okay,
Mike Russell.
Yes, in question of assignation, I don't want it to harp on the 1948 Act too much. You'll think I was there. But I do think that there was, the 1948 Act had a much more flexible view of assignation than subsequent acts. Now, this bill is taking us back to a more flexible view. There is an argument that Dave Thompson has put for open assignation or the ability of open assignation at value, which would allow landowners to take land back if they chose to do so, but there would be a fairer system of buying out tenancies than presently exist, and of course there are current cases which are difficult in that regard. Did you consider the question of open assignation as value tied to a fit and proper person test? Because if there is a fit and proper person test, that is, an estate cannot be, a farm cannot simply be assigned to somebody who has no experience of agriculture, you do actually have quite a strong way of taking forward tenanted land, but it does not remove all the rights of the landlord.
You're perfectly correct in that the situation in 1948 was much closer to open assignation, and again, for reasons we've gone over, a lot of the legislation has changed dramatically since 1948. so it wouldn't be as easy to return to that as what you might think or what we'd like if we did choose that as a policy option. We only consider it as far as the recommendations from the review group were concerned who'd looked at this issue. And, you know, for that reason, we've not revisited it in terms of putting it in the bill for open assignation, again, for the reasons I gave in response to Dave Thompson's questions. But I'm not ruling anything out. And, you know, it's one of the issues in the background of how we take this bill forward. So, you know, if the committee's got strong views on open assignation, we will listen to that closely.
If you had open assignation and a fit and proper person test, and you would then give a security in tenure, which is greater now. I mean, I certainly support the provisions here, but I think you can go a step further. That would then create the circumstance in which what many landlords wish, which is freedom of contract, could be introduced with greater confidence, because there would be a stability in the market, and it would then be for individuals to choose it. Now, I think in freedom of contract, you would have to create a circumstance where there was no, and there was proof of no coercion, essentially. But freedom of contract is not in itself unattractive to many people in agriculture on both sides, providing there is a stronger support for tenancies and the continuation of tenancies. Is that a mix which you might be prepared to think about?
It's certainly a mix that I think would be essential if we were to go down that road. I think, you know, we are aware that there are those arguments, and therefore the government's position would be that if open assignation were to be taken forward or considered in more detail, there would have to be these issues around it.
Thank you.
Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I'm wondering, following on from the discussion we're having on succession and assignation, whether you're considering the possibility of someone who's worked on a farm throughout their working life or for a certain period of years, such as a shepherd, which is an example I came across, of widening it to those as well as to the categories that you have there, because that's just a point that has come up in evidence.
It's an interesting point. Again, if I can maybe take that away and reflect upon it, whether that be appropriate.
Thank you.
I suppose I should raise at this moment the question about, you know, we're looking at the idea of the countryside being populated, we're looking at the idea of families being able to farm, and I hope that we're thinking in terms, despite the varieties of shape of families in this day and age, that we'd still see that very much at the heart of what we're trying to do, because you know, when we talk about the bare question of somebody farming a piece of land, that's all very well, but people actually being able to live there is clearly a very important part of the thing that we've experienced as we go around and take evidence. And there seem to be real difficulties that people have in so doing. We'll come to one or two of them slightly later on. But is that a kind of fundamental principle that you believe in when we're talking about the means to transfer from one generation to another or to another active farmer?
I certainly do, and you know, I think many of the measures we're discussing today, and again, I reiterate, this is just one part of the debate. This is the legislation. There's other many equally important parts of the debate, such as the Common Agricultural Policy, and we have to find ways of knocking down the obstacles for allowing people to be able to farm in all parts of Scotland where it's appropriate, and we've got good agricultural land for keeping people on the land and working on the land.
Yeah, I thought I'd make that point because it seems to me to be underpinning. Thinking about compensation for tenants' improvements. Jim Hume.
Thank you very much, Convener. Yes, it's quite a simplistic question. Sections 19 to 95 provide for an amnesty period for 2 years when a tenant can bring forward improvements that they have made, so they can obviously be compensated in the future. That is set at 2 years at the moment. Evidence we've had, and even the Scottish Land and the Estates said that 3 years would be perfectly reasonable. Therefore, just wondering if the government's minded to leave it at the 2 years, or whether it's considering to perhaps widen it out to 3 years or even more.
I mean, our initial view has been that 2 years is ample time. However, you know, clearly, as part of the consultation process and scrutiny process, you know, other arguments are being made that should be longer than 2 years. So I don't have a closed mind on that. If the committee wants to come back with a view, we'll look at that. I tend to think 2 years is a reasonable amount of time, but you know, if you've got other views as a committee, please convey them to us.
Sounds like a whatever.
Well, you know.
Yeah. No, that's fine. That's fine.
If there's good substantive arguments put forward as to why 3 years, better than 2 years, of course, we'll listen to those arguments.
Okay, no, that's fine. Thank you for that.
Move swiftly on to compensation and WAGO. Alec Ferguson.
Yes, I think we all agree probably that the current process of WAGO is a mess and it needs to be smartened up and clarified. And I think actually doing so would help to restore some of the trust that is currently lost in the whole system. I wonder whether you have views on whether or not the two-stage process that the committee has taken evidence on and looked at, are you sympathetic to a two-stage process of WAGO?
Again, we have been looking at this and we're open-minded about whether that should be a two-stage process. I can see the advantages. I'm just not clear of how essential it is. And therefore, if the committee again has views on whether it should be a two-stage process, we're open-minded about that.
I think we probably all agree, I can't guarantee that, that it's only fair to the tenant to know what he's going to leave with before he finally decides to leave, if I can put it that way, and the two-stage process would help to bring that about. But I'm sure we'll make comment on that in our report at stage one.
So yeah, I can see some advantages, whether it's absolutely essential, I don't know. So if the arguments are input that it would make a big difference, then clearly we'd maybe be willing to look at that.
We've also heard evidence that the list of improvements that are eligible for compensation at WAGO possibly needs to be updated. Is there any thoughts of maybe including some of that on the bill, or is this something else that will be left to secondary legislation?
I suspect the latter. I'm not
sure.
Maybe for the first time in this evidence session, I can call on assistance from my colleagues here of where that's reached, that issue.
Yeah, we are aware that it needs to be updated and improved. Stakeholders have already made some representations, including as part of the rental review work, where we've been looking at some of these issues. So it is an issue that we'll have to look at and improve, and that will be done over time at secondary legislation.
Just wanted to get that on for the 11th time, you know. Thank you.
Just while we're on the question of leases and so on, we had a question about repairing leases, which was raised by the public in Dumfries, and we're interested in the government whether you're still considering the repairing lease to be a proposal for a 35-year repairing lease. Is it aimed at new entrants, or is it aimed at other farmers to actually extend what they have already? Because we're quite keen, from the point of view of the questioner in Dumfries, that it should be aimed at new entrants.
Well, we're supportive of the concept of repairing leases, and we're looking at the options of when it would be most appropriate to take that forward. The big benefit, I think, would be for new entrants. So I don't necessarily think it would be only for new entrants, but I think it's fair to say that those that stand to benefit would be new entrants, if it makes the lease more attractive and that the new tenant would not have to have a higher rent to pay for fixed equipment or whatever it may be.
So is it likely to be a 35-year repairing lease, or would it be shorter or whatever?
Well, I think we face the same debates with that as we face with the other timescales, with other leases.
Okay, well, I'm glad we've raised
but
that.
But some of these issues, of course, can be agreed with two agreeable parties. This is, in terms of legislation, though, we'd have to think carefully about the timescale.
No, thank you very much for that. We've got some other issues to raise. Sarah Boyack is going to do that.
Thank you very much, Convener. One of the issues that we've been grappling with throughout the process, partly in relation to agricultural tenancies, but also in relation to wider community issues, is the whole issue of affordable social and private housing in rural communities. And at the public meeting we heard in Dura, that was one of the top issues in terms of lack of affordable housing, lack of access to housing. It's a particular issue for retiring farmers, but it's also an issue about enabling young people either to stay and live and work in an area or to be attracted to an area. So I think the committee would be very keen to get an update from you, Cabinet Secretary, about the Scottish Government's plans to ensure we have more affordable social and private housing made available across rural Scotland in the future.
I'm happy to send that update to the committee. As Sarah Boyack says, it's a very important issue. I did write to all local authorities in Scotland, I recall, a few years ago when we were taking forward our first new entrance initiatives, urging them to give priority to planning for homes for retiring farmers or for new entrants, etc. So it's something that we have to revisit as quickly as possible in terms of my portfolio, but in terms of housing ministers, this is very much at the forefront of their thoughts in terms of affordable housing policy. So if the committee would allow me to speak to my colleagues and get back to you with an update, I'll happily do that.
I think that'd be very helpful. I suppose the point you made about writing to local authorities, do you have a sense in terms of responses of what impact that's made in terms of generating new opportunities for retiring farmers?
Well, I think it's quite mixed. I find it difficult to answer the question because I don't know the information on retiring farmers, but the picture's quite mixed in terms of planning permission for agriculture purposes for homes. So there are local authorities who do give extra weight to planning applications for agricultural jobs. But I think that's quite patchy, so I don't have an analysis to make available on that to the committee, but I'll certainly look into it.
I think that'd be really helpful. In terms of people who work on farms as well as farmers themselves, there are lots of affordability issues.
I've actually had cases where people have wanted to reverse. Yeah. So they're agricultural workers who want the conditions relaxed in their homes.
It goes back to the point that colleagues were making earlier, I think, about particularly for tenant farmers, when you stop farming, what are you left with? Whether you've got a pension, whether you've got somewhere to go and live, is a really, really big issue. And the other thing was what impact you see with this legislation in terms of the community right to buy opportunities, in terms of delivering that kind of affordable housing in communities that currently don't have a lot of people living there or don't have the opportunities.
Well, there's no better illustration of sustainable development being hampered whereby communities are unable to have affordable housing for the next generation. So I think that is a very relevant debate, the community right to buy. And time will tell to what extent communities want to take advantage of what's made available to them in terms of these new measures to build affordable housing. But clearly it's a prime example of why we need to ensure communities do have the ability to acquire land for housing purposes.
Thanks, Minister. I think that's helpful because one of the issues we talked about on Monday with your colleague was about the purpose of the bill and about what the sustainable development mean and what it will mean in the future for communities. So thank you for that.
Good. Mike Russell, then Claudia Beamish.
Yeah, I think this is one of the key parts of the bill that isn't really yet in a position where we can grab hold of it, but needs to come in the second at stage two. And, all bills change at stage two, all bills develop at stage two, and there are opportunities. And there are two areas I'd ask you to comment on. They're linked. One is the question of the Commission and the role of the Commission, particularly as a land agency. There is a lot of public land out there. There may be the prospect for more public land if the issue becomes whether land needs to be purchased for agricultural tenancing. The Commission doesn't seem to be able to fulfil the role of a land agency. And a land agency, which has been much discussed, would then be in a position to look at the use of public land, and particularly the use of public land for housing. So that's issue one. Connected to it is there's nothing in the bill that gives ministers essentially a right to push forward, for example, forced sale of land so that land can become available for social purposes. The initiative lies with communities. There's no bad thing in that. But sometimes that's not going to happen. When I look at many communities in Argyll, there isn't often the capability or the infrastructure within those communities to allow those things to happen. So I think I think we would all be grateful, I suspect, from whatever side we come from, be grateful for further thinking on this in terms of the bill so that the bill can do something in terms of pushing forward the issue of rural social housing and can do so in a way that's going to make some early progress. Because we are suffering, in the West particularly, substantial depopulation. And that is not presently being assisted by local authorities, certainly not by the local authority in my area. And we need to get some radical action.
In response to Michael Russell's point, which I think is a very exciting debate, I would say that, land reform in Scotland at the moment is at a very exciting juncture. And there are clearly other areas, we're going to have to spend a lot more effort to take forward in terms of how we have more joined up approaches, for instance, in Scotland's land, a publicly owned land. And whilst the Land Commission is not a land agency, clearly we do now face the opportunity of the devolution of the Crown Estate, if that ever happens, in a way in which it will actually make a material difference to Scotland's communities. And we have the Land Reform Bill and the Land Commission being set up, and we have our existing functions in terms of publicly owned land in Scotland. And of course we have the other initiatives underway, such as using publicly owned land for new starter units for farmers. And I do feel we need to join that up a lot more. So the issue around the land agency and which agency at the moment performs the role of a land agency, or whether we have to create something new, is certainly to the forefront of the government's minds, because we are now at a position where it makes sense to think about the best way forward for managing publicly owned land in Scotland. And that, quite rightly, as Michael Russell says, could range from making opportunities available for affordable housing to new starter units for farmers or whatever. So it's a really exciting agenda, a really exciting place just now in the land reform story in Scotland and land management story, which could open up lots of new opportunities for communities and for Scotland's economy and for future generations. And the only final point I would make is that in terms of compulsory purchasing land for affordable housing, I'm not going to delve into the area of local government policy, but clearly there are powers there with local government at the moment that can be used. So there are various tools in the box at the moment. Land reform legislation will hopefully give solutions for many scenarios, but there are some there already that have just not been used.
History of, if I might convene, the history of you know, local authorities and public sector compulsory purchase, for example, is a poor one. From, you know, Dr. Green on RASE all those years ago. I'm conscious I'm acting almost as a historian these days every time I ask a question. But, you know, from Dr. Green and RASE onwards, that's not been highly successful. And many would argue that the compulsory purchase powers of local authorities are essentially too slow, too cumbersome to be used. We need a very clear, targeted powers to actually solve what the housing situation is, in rural areas particularly, though in other areas as well. And also see land as a public asset, because the other benefit of having a land commission and a land agency is to change the relationship with land, for us all to understand that land is a public asset and should be working for the good of the community, not just for the good of one or two individuals.
And I advise the committee, you know, perhaps to consider putting your own ideas to the Land Commission and, you know, what they should be looking at in their early days. We all come across situations in our constituencies and we think, I wonder if the land reform legislation will cope with this circumstance, and if not, perhaps it's something the Land Commission can look at in early days. So, you know, there's an opportunity for the committee there to put its views to the Land Commission.
Claudia Beamish, then Jim Hume, then Alec Ferguson, then me.
Right. Last but not least, convener. Cabinet Secretary, could I just focus briefly on the issue of tenant farmers' actual homes, which in some cases, and I stress in some cases, have been in a frankly dilapidated state from what we have heard and also some of the things that we've seen over my time on the Rural Affairs Committee and as a South Scotland MSP. And if those types of conditions were with a different form of private landlord, which we're looking at in other ways in the Scottish Parliament, that would be completely unacceptable. And I appreciate there are different forms of rent, there are different forms of tenancy, but I wonder if in your deliberations you can look at this issue of modern homes for tenants.
It's a very important issue in terms of ensuring that a career in agriculture is attractive if you have a nice house to live in with your family when you're not working the farm. So I will look at that. I think it's a good point, and if you allow me again to come back to the committee on that, particularly looking at the interaction between the tenancy arrangements for the farmhouse and other tenancy arrangements for private landlords in the country. That may be good to do.
Okay, so
Jim Hume, then Alec Ferguson.
That was more or less the point that I was going to make as well. I'll just re-emphasise it. Obviously, normal housing tenants, whether they're in the private sector or socially rented homes, they've given protection of, you know, repairs to roofs are done. They have electricity and gas safety certificates. They have carbon monoxide monitors in their homes. They have fire alarms set, and none of these are afforded to, of course, the tendencies that we see at the moment, because the actual farmhouses, as you know, are seen as part of commercial property, and I think we've all seen houses and been in houses that you would think would not in any way be fit for human habitation if they were in either private rented sector or the normal social rented houses. So I'm just re-emphasising Claudia's point.
That's a fair point, and I'll certainly take that away.
And Alec Ferguson?
It's really a comment, but I just wanted to say that certainly in my constituency experience, the lack of rural affordable housing is down far more to infrastructure constraints than it is to lack of land availability. I don't know of any community that hasn't found land to build or to have affordable housing built on, where the infrastructure has been up to it, but the problem is more to do with infrastructure complaints than it is about land availability. I may not speak for the whole of rural Scotland on that.
There's no doubt that is an issue, but clearly there are a number of issues, and there are many empty homes in Scotland that could be used in our rural communities if they were improved. And again, the government's conscious of these issues, and action has been taken, so I'll get back to the committee about that.
I think, Cabinet Secretary, you can see that the issue of housing, particularly on farms and indeed rural housing as such, is something that's, it's really hit us in every part of Scotland that we've visited. And therefore, we hope that you will be making the kind of approach to the planning review that would allow for land to be available, and indeed for means to actually use the powers that exist for compulsory purchase and so on. But there's another part to it as well. When we were in Jura, one of the estates suggested that they had setting up 7 crofts. Now, these would be new crofts which couldn't be bought, but none of these have been taken up because people weren't able to build a house in that part of Jura to be able to live there and run that piece of land. Now, the point about that is appalling, because at least it was an attempt to try and create some new crofts. But I wonder whether, like in the past, the Department of Agriculture had designs for houses which crofters and others could build. And before crofting was separated from the rest of agriculture in 1955, these models were used throughout the country. We need up-to-date eco-friendly housing models which are agreed by the agriculture and rural affairs people, and that planners understand that these designs would be given priority when houses are being built. And I believe if we did that, and we had particularly wooden houses that are eco-friendly and built in prefabricated form, that it might well be possible for more people to have a good house to live in the kinds of places that I've described in Jura just now, because these things seem to me to be fundamental to dealing with climate change, etc., and dealing with the potential for people to actually have economy in the houses that they built, and that if there are a series of models, that might be a main means to ensure that we actually bring this to the fore as an idea that actually planners have to agree to, and agree to very quickly.
Perfect point, and clearly the guidance that's issued by Scottish Government to local authorities is one vehicle where that kind of initiative could be taken forward, so I could raise that with my planning colleagues in the Government, and we'll incorporate that into my response to the committee after today. It's a good point. And there are many members around the table who represent stunning rural constituencies in Scotland, and you'll be aware there are fantastic rural designs for homes, and there's no reason why they should be blocked by local authorities, unless they're really insensitive locations. So, yep, we need the support of local authorities taking that forward. But the idea of having some designs that can show it can be done is a good idea.
Dave Thompson wanted to make a final point, did you?
Yeah, I did indeed, Convener. Thank you very much for letting me in. Just to say that there's been an interesting debate in Highland between the council and various local folk in relation to Section 75 agreements in relation to building houses in the countryside, and the folk who owned the land actually won their appeal, and I was very pleased about that. And it's just on that general point of planning to finish off, Cabinet Secretary. I believe in the likes of Ireland, there's a presumption in favour of rural housing, whereas here it's the opposite. And with the planning review going through now, I would hope that the government will be looking very, very carefully at encouraging folk in the countryside to be able to build on land that is available. And if there was a presumption in favour of rural housing, that, I think, would serve a number of purposes. It would allow far more houses to be built in the countryside. It would help to cut waiting lists, give people an opportunity, and, you know, free up land for housing in a way that would cost the government nothing, you know, and would allow us to tackle what is a very, very serious housing problem in my constituency and others in the Highlands and elsewhere.
Again, fair points, and I'm sure my ministerial colleagues will be more than happy to come before the committee and discuss rural housing policy with you.
Maybe I know it's a subject that's been endemic in this.
My own view, just to finish on that theme, is, and I have expressed this before to local authorities, is that our local authorities in Scotland, I would urge to have rural development policies. And when they have a rural development policy, they're able to join up the housing policy with the farming policy, and so on and so forth.
Well, we can see that that's the kind of things that underpin a lot of our discussions about this, that people can live in the countryside and we want them to be able to do so. I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and his team for their evidence, and we will now be able to consider what to do with all of this. That concludes our evidence taking on the bill. The committee will now consider its views and publish a Stage 1 report to Parliament in early December. This will be published on the committee's website. At the next meeting of the committee on the 11th of November, the committee will consider two negative instruments and take evidence from the Minister for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform, Dr. Aileen MacLeod, on the UN Climate Change Conference in Paris in November 2015. And as previously agreed, the committee will now move into private session to consider evidence heard this morning and at previous sessions. And I now close the public part of the meeting and ask the gallery to be cleared. We'll have a short recess.